Bob Dylan is perhaps one of history's greatest singer-songwriters, with poetic lyrics that catapulted him to fame in the early 60s. Regarded as the voice of his generation, Dylan's folk and rock and roll music reflected how young people felt about America's unstable society during the Vietnam War, the Cuban Missile Crisis, the Civil Rights Movement, and many more historical events. Today, we're going to give you 10 very interesting facts you might not know about the legendary Bob Dylan. When Bob Dylan performed at his high school talent show in the late 50s, the school's principal turned off his microphone and pulled a curtain down on him. Dylan formed a handful of bands while in high school and often tried to mix up the usual music the kids in his town were listening to. At this one talent show in particular, Dylan performed a set that mixed country music and rock and roll, creating a sound that his classmates were not familiar with. His friend, B.J. Rawlson, recounts the incident, referring to Dylan by his real name, Robert, saying, "Robert was up on stage. His concert began and it was quite surprising. I saw Robert standing there at the piano and my guess was that he was trying to destroy it. He was pounding on the thing. It was the most unusual thing to observe. The principal pulled the curtain on him. He didn't think the music was suitable for the audience." The performance was specifically cut during Dylan and his band's rendition of Rock and Roll Is Here to Stay. Dylan says that nobody liked country music, the blues, and rock and roll, and so he wasn't surprised with the audience's shock. While he started out performing rock and roll covers in high school, Dylan quickly switched to folk music because he thought it reflected more of the way he felt about life. Dylan says, "The thing about rock and roll is that for me anyway, it wasn't enough. There were great catchphrases and driving pulse rhythms, but the songs weren't serious or didn't reflect life in a realistic way. I knew that when I got into folk music, it was more of a serious type of thing. The songs are filled with more despair, more sadness, more triumph, more faith in the supernatural, much deeper feelings." After having this realization, he switched his electric guitar for an acoustic one. He began learning how to play covers of folk music, which he could do by listening to a song only one or two times. He picked up the techniques and sounds of folk singers, including Odetta, Dave Van Ronk, Fred Neil, and his biggest inspiration, Woody Guthrie. Dylan explains Guthrie's influence on him, saying, "The songs themselves had the infinite sweep of humanity in them. He was a true voice of the American spirit. I said to myself, I'm going to be Guthrie's great disciple." Blowing in the Wind, Dylan's 1963 hit single, is considered one of the greatest protest songs of all time. Its philosophical lyrics and rhetorical questions are meant to make listeners reflect on peace, war, and freedom. Just like the poetic lyrics themselves, Dylan speaks simply yet eloquently about the song, saying, "There ain't too much I can say about this song except that the answer is blowing in the wind. It ain't no book or movie or TV show or discussion group. Man, it's in the wind. And it's blowing in the wind. Too many of these hip people are telling me where the answer is, but oh, I won't believe that. I still say it's in the wind, and just like a restless piece of paper, it gotta come down some. But the only trouble is that no one picks up the answer when it comes down, so not too many people get to see and know, and then it flies away." The song has many accolades, including its introduction into the Grammy Hall of Fame and being placed at number 14 on the Rolling Stones 500 Greatest Songs of All Time in 2004. As part of the Civil Rights Movement, Dylan performed at the March on Washington in 1963. Famous for his protest songs at this point in his career, Dylan performed Only a Pawn in the Game, When the Ship Comes In, Blowin' in the Wind, and Keep Your Eyes on the Prize. He was accompanied by Joan Baez, fellow folk singer and then girlfriend. Baez partially led the crowd in singing We Shall Overcome and Oh Freedom. Other musical performers at the historical event included Mahalia Jackson, Marian Anderson, and Peter, Paul, and Mary. Dylan recalls the experience, saying, "I looked up from the podium and I remember thinking to myself, I've never seen such a large crowd. I was up close when King was giving that speech. To this day, it still affects me in a profound way." Some activists criticize Dylan for performing at the march, given he is a white man. These activists hope Dylan would have stood with those affected rather than in front. Dylan himself also expressed discomfort with being white and having taken on such a public role at the march. When Dylan headlined the 1965 Newport Folk Festival, he was practically booed off the stage. He had made appearances at the festival in 1963 and 1964, both of which were met with great success and were responsible for propelling his career. However, when he returned in 65 with an electric set and background musicians, much of the audience criticized him for being a sellout and a phony. After performing just three songs, he left the stage and returned with his acoustic guitar. One of the electric songs he played was his then newly released single, Like a Rolling Stone, which would ironically come to be regarded as Dylan's best song. Despite the day being widely known as the Electric Dylan controversy, it has often been reported that the negative reaction was overplayed and that most of the audience was very happy with Dylan's performance. Additionally, there is confusion over whether the booing was in regards to the sound quality or the songs itself. But Pete Seeger, the famous folk singer and friend of Dylan, threatened to cut the cables with an axe because of how distorted he thought Dylan sounded. Dylan says Like a Rolling Stone changed the trajectory of his career. The hit single from 1965 marked a turning point in Dylan's career, as it had a more rock and electric sound compared to his typical folk songs. Columbia Records disapproved of the song for many reasons. To start, Like a Rolling Stone was a lengthy 6 minutes. It was originally 10 to 20 pages worth of lyrics long, so cutting it down to 6 minutes was still just a portion of what Dylan had written. The rock and roll sound for Dylan was also widely contested, as he made his career on folk music and protest songs. But as we know, the song ultimately became a huge success. Dylan explains its origins and background, saying, "It wasn't called anything, just a rhythm thing on paper all about my steady hatred directed at some point that was honest. In the end, it wasn't hatred. It was telling someone something they didn't know, telling them that they were lucky. Revenge, that's a better word. I never thought of it as a song until one day I was at the piano, and on the paper it was singing, 'How does it feel?' in a slow motion pace, in the utmost of slow motion." Dylan got in a pretty bad motorcycle accident in 1966, which he actually has appreciation due to what it taught him. Before the crash, Dylan was on a tour, which he described as exhausting and draining. Dylan and his close circle said that the crash allowed him to take a break from the pressures the world was placing on him to be the voice of their generation. It was a blessing in disguise, allowing him to get out of what he called the rat race of life. Dylan says, "In 1966, I had a motorcycle accident and ended up with several broken vertebrae and a concussion. That put me down for a while. I couldn't go on doing what I had been. I was pretty wound up before that accident happened. It sent me down so I could see things in a better perspective. I wasn't seeing anything in any kind of perspective. I probably would have died if I had kept going the way I had been." The accident resulted in Dylan taking an 8-year break from touring, with the exception of a few public appearances. Dylan embarked on his never-ending tour in June of 1988 and has played over 3,000 shows as a part of it. The name of the tour was coined by a journalist named Adrian Devoy. However, Dylan has dismissed its name. He says, "Don't be bewildered by the never-ending tour chatter. There was a never-ending tour, but it ended in 1991 with the departure of guitarist G.E. Smith. That one's long gone, but there have been many others since. The Money Never Runs Out tour, Southern Sympathizer tour, Why Do You Look at Me So Strangely tour, The One Sad Cry of Pity tour, Outburst of Consciousness tour, Don't Let Your Deal Go Down tour, and others. Too many to mention each without their own character and design." Essentially, people combined all these tours spanning the past 3 decades into one and called it the Never-Ending Tour. Dylan and his backing band have performed across the world and are joined by different famous musicians during some concerts. The tour was still going on up until March of 2020, when it was unfortunately canceled because of the COVID pandemic. Dylan has won 2 very prestigious awards. Starting in May of 2012, President Barack Obama awarded Dylan with the Presidential Medal of Freedom, which is the highest honor a civilian can receive in the U.S. President Obama said Dylan's voice was a unique gravelly power that redefined not just what music sounded like, but the message it carried and how it made people feel, and that there is not a bigger giant in the history of American music. Dylan received the medal all while wearing a pair of sunglasses. Just 4 years later, in October of 2016, Dylan received the Nobel Prize in Literature. The Swedish Academy, which is responsible for giving the award, says Dylan won for, quote, "having created new poetic expressions within the great American song tradition." Dylan was the first musician to win the award, making it all the more honorable. He could not attend the ceremony, so Patti Smith accepted the award for him and performed his song, A Hard Rain's A-Gonna Fall. Although he was quiet weeks after the ceremony, when asked by a reporter what he thought of the award, Dylan responded saying, "Amazing, incredible, whoever dreams about something like that." Dylan was a member of the Traveling Wilburys, whose members included George Harrison, Jeff Lynne, Roy Orbison, and Tom Petty, known as rock's ultimate supergroup. The band's first album actually helped Dylan revitalize his career. Harrison advocated to get Dylan in the band despite the fact that he was experiencing a lull in his career. But before Dylan joined the group in 1988, co-founder Lynne did not think Harrison was going to be able to get a star like Dylan on the project. And once they did, Dylan's superstardom was promptly addressed. On the first day of working together, Harrison said to Dylan, "We know that you're Bob Dylan and everything, but we're going to just treat you and talk to you like we would anybody else." To which Dylan replied, "Well, great. Believe it or not, I'm in awe of you guys, and it's the same for me." Work was split evenly, but Dylan often took on the lead vocals during recording sessions. Although the Traveling Wilburys only released two albums, the incomparable lineup made them incredibly popular, and they experienced great commercial success. Well, that's all for today, everyone. We hope you enjoy the video, and we'll see you next time.